music that helps you make it through your busy day. We're Majesty Radio, hymns and inspirational favorites.
Just amazes me. Circumstances possibly change who I forever am in you.
morning. Welcome. After that crazy storm yesterday, it's good to see all of you here today. Our church is safe. No harm has been done to anybody's house, I don't think. So praise God for his protection over us through that storm last night. I just want a little announcement. Next week is potluck, so remember that and bring a dish to pass. I will not be here, but I'm sure you guys will all survive without me. But if you could help in the kitchen, that would be great. let's just bow our heads for a word of prayer as we open the service. Dear God, thank you for the many blessings that you give to us, Lord. Help us to remember every day the blessings that you have provided for us. Help us to have a grateful heart. Lord, help our minds to turn to you now as we sing praises to you and as we listen to your message for us today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please stand as we sing praises to God. We're doing some oldies today, so I want to hear you guys all singing.
Great. strength from sin to set me free. Some days I'll meet back. What glory that will be. Wonderful is love for me.
Amen. Father, your love is wonderful, and we appreciate your faithfulness, and may our eyes be open to your mercies. Your love is so pure, pure above anything of this earth. We pray for forgiveness, that our eyes may be open to the needs of others and to be able to reach out to them accordingly. We pray for the anointing of your Holy Spirit on each one of us and of our families, our friends. This world needs the anointing of your Holy Spirit. We look forward to the day when you come back, and we pray that the circles will be unbroken, that we will be before you and be able to see your love. Thank you for your watch care. We love you, Jesus. We also pray that you be with Diana as she gives us your word. May we hear the message you have for each one of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's nice to see you all. Welcome to this hour. They call it the divine hour, when we can open our Bibles, when we can read the Word of God. And we want to just bow our heads right now and ask for the Holy Spirit. Father in heaven, we pray for the Holy Spirit to fill each and every one of us. May they hear the message that you want them to hear. May the Holy Spirit give understanding, Lord. And we thank you for this divine hour where we worship you together. In Jesus' name, amen. So, my message today is called Spiritual Refresh. And the last few weeks, my son and I, we have been cleaning out our house, the upstairs. I had my brother-in-law put in a new bathroom, and it was so pretty. We now have to refinish the floors so they don't look so awful next to the new floor in the bathroom, you know. You know, one thing leads to another, right? And it's quite a chore, because everything has to come out of the rooms eventually by a certain date, so that the floor refinisher can come in. And we have been in that house for over 30 years. And I know I've gotten rid of stuff over the years, but not enough, believe me. And things happen in your life, you know, and you don't want to deal with your stuff, and it just mounds up. You wouldn't have believed it. Well, anyway. It's why I got a cabin, so that we could, you know, kind of get out of there and go where it's really nice, you know. But there comes a point of reckoning, and you have to deal with all your stuff. And, you know, we're trying to figure out, you know, what do you keep? What do you throw away? What do you give away? You know, you've heard it, your three boxes, you know. And it's very interesting. We already filled a dumpster. It was just my linen closet and what was in the bathroom and the garage, you know. And also from tearing things out, we filled the whole thing. And now we're doing the bedrooms, and we can see we're going to need another dumpster because, you know, there's papers. They don't mean anything anymore. They're old, you know. The time has come, and it is gone. There's clothing that doesn't fit anymore. You're just ready to move on to something new and less of, you don't need so much. And, you know, it's been kind of interesting in my life. I got to thinking, people like to give me their clothes. And I can remember, and Terry knows Jan, she had a bypass surgery, and she said, okay, Diane, I'm going to give you all my clothes because I know you'll take care of them. And I don't want to give them to just anyone. So there they were in my closet for several years. And finally, I just, you know, because clothes are a very personal thing, you know. And and then I remember Dolores, she gave me a suitcase one day, and she said, it's all my clothes. You know, I don't wear them anymore. And I thought, I'm not going to wear them either, but I took them, you know. And my sister, she had an operation. She's got beautiful things, so I held on to some of her things, you know. And but it's just that, you know, I seem to be somebody that people like to give their clothes to, and now I'm just like ready to just take it all out. My aunt, I gotta tell you this, she's in a wheelchair. She flew into Chicago with a suitcase of my deceased Aunt Beulah's clothes that she thought I might like, and I'm going, you know, and Billy hasn't heard all of this before. But anyway, you know, it's nice to clean out the closet. It's nice to have just enough of what you need and nothing more, you know. So we're cleaning out and we're getting rid of. And it is grueling. It's a grueling process. But I'll tell you this, you know, I'm going up and down the stairs. And, you know, I have been weak because I have a desk job. And, you know, sitting at a desk for 8 hours is not good for you. Suddenly, I have more strength. I have strength in my legs because of all the going up and down the stairs, of all the going to the garage and, you know, all the things that I have had to do. And there is a blessing to doing the grueling work and getting it done. And you can start feeling lighter. We're not 100% there yet, but it's coming. The day is coming. It can take 100 years or you could do it now, you know, and get it all cleaned and fresh so that you can enjoy the life that God wants you to enjoy. You know, even making decisions on all that stuff, you know, you start out slow, and then before you know it, you're just filling bags, and you're just like putting it out, you know, in the driveway until the dumpster comes. We don't want things to weigh us down in this life. There's enough going on. And it causes a lot of anxiety, and being overwhelmed is really quite paralyzing. A lot of things can take place in your life. You know, you're raising your children, and there's blessings, there's losses. Sometimes you lose your parents. Both my parents have passed. We, you know, helped to take care of them when they needed it, and it was very consuming, but it was a blessing. But, you know, things can build up during those kinds of times, during times of trauma. Maybe you've had it, you know, and where you just couldn't function. Dealing with loss is, while you're still raising your family, still working, things can build up. And now it's time to clean it up. You know, how many books do you need? How many clothes do you need? Magazines, you know, shoes, old purses, all those kinds of things. And now it's time to do a cleansing, so to speak, because we're in another time in our lives where you want to do and free yourself up. My son said that I was like a mouse. And mice like to, mouse things away. They have, you'll find things under your pillow sometimes. Well, I never did. But my sister would find Cheerios at the cabin under her pillow, you know, or they put out Decon, you know, and she'd find that under her pillow, you know. And my son said, you just know how to put things away and you just, you know, and but no more of that, you know. And so we're going through a cleansing, and then there is also, I thought, this is a great time to talk about being spiritually refreshed, because we can also need a cleansing spiritually from all of the things that have been going on in our lives and consuming us and bothering us and all the things that we're doing, you know, all the busy work of that sometimes gets involved in church, and you need to take time for yourself. And I'll tell you this, that during the process, sometimes it was very late after work that I would be doing a lot of the cleaning, a lot of getting rid of, bagging things up, and I had to take a lot of time to just sit down and rest in between. And I decided that that would be my time with God. And so I've spent a lot of time with him on my stairs, from the upstairs going down to the lower level, you know, just sitting on the stairs and, you know, talking to God and having a just nice conversation with him. It's, you know, asking for help and strength and when you're feeling so tired, and so I can get through the grueling work. And it's been very helpful, and I hope that I keep that up. We need not only to sweep out our closets, but to dust off our Bibles. The Word of God is a lamp unto our feet, and always shows us the best way to go in life, in our directions. And if we don't have time to open up our Bibles, because of all this other stuff, all the clutter going on in your life, you're going to be struggling on a daily basis. We need to cleanse our hearts to become spiritually healthy, drawing close to God and allowing our hearts and bodies to be cleansed. It says in Psalm 51:10, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." And if you open up to that scripture, it really says a lot about David and what he had gone through, the mistakes, the terrible mistakes and sins in his life that led him to a place of desperation. And I wanted to read more than just that. As you know, we sing a lot of the words in Psalm 51, and he says, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin." I could see him sitting on the stairs in my house, you know, as we can do in all of our houses, and talking to God just like this. And then it goes on to say in the fifth verse, "Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place." He's asking him to continue, you know, to show him these things. "Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I'll be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquity." And this is beautiful. "Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me." He had done things that he knew he could be cast away from the presence of the Lord forever. But here he is sitting down with God, and he's, please, don't take me away from your presence. And then it says, as it says here in the verse 10, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. I think that's beautiful. In Hebrews 10:22, it says, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. And baptism is always a beautiful sign of change in our lives. You know, it says in the Bible that when we become followers of Jesus Christ, when we are baptized, representing the cleansing that takes place when we are followers of Jesus, a great testimony not only for ourselves of a commitment, but also to our church body, to our friends and family. You know, when we do that, it's a beautiful ritual or thing that we do. It's just a cleansing experience. And then deep clean your mouth inside and out. Now, I over the long years that I've had so far in my life, the world is way different today even than when I was a child. Well, of course, when I was a child, I saw things as a child would see them. But today, language is terrible. You know, people just use bad words that we would shudder about as children if we heard them, just as normal conversation. And it's important that we deep clean our mouth inside and out. And I believe that when we are true Christians, followers of Jesus Christ, that we become a new creature, just like the scriptures say. The old is gone, the new has come. It is a process because we have our old habits, but we need to really develop within ourselves a cleansing of our mouths. It used to be, you know, I'm gonna wash your mouth out with soap, you know. Nobody ever did that. I don't think it's healthy, you know. I think you can make moss. Oh, I had some hands back there. They've had it done. But do you remember when Isaiah went into vision and he saw the angels above him saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And do you remember when he was going to be commissioned to take a message out to the people that one of those angels comes down with a hot coal and touches his lips to cleanse his words? It's a beautiful, beautiful vision or visual of what God expects from his people. And what does he say? Woe is me, when he sees this vision of Jesus on the throne. And he says, woe is me, I am undone because of who I am and what I have been. And it changed him from the inside out, that beautiful experience of being in the very presence of God with his angels. You know, the angels, it is said, they would have two wings to cover their face, two wings to cover their feet, and two wings to fly with. And that in the presence of God, you know, they honored him. They glorified him. There is none more pure or holy or loving or good than God. And we are his children, and he has chosen to love us. It's a beautiful thing. So we want to be changed when we follow Jesus. We want to be in his presence. Take me not, cast me not from your presence, O Lord. It's a cleansing from inside and out. And it not only includes bad words, but it also includes negative talk, pessimistic thoughts that contradict the word of God and faith. This includes the challenge to stop complaining. You know, like Jeremiah, he had good reason, I have to say. But, you know, woe is me. Look at what I'm living through. Elijah, he didn't want to be here anymore. Come and get me. He knew there was a ride out of here. Somehow he knew that chariot could come and take him up to heaven, and that's what he wanted. Because he couldn't take it anymore. He was a depressed man. But we need to stop complaining and being pessimistic. And sometimes that is a bad habit as well. In Luke 6:45, it says, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart. For out of the overflow of his heart, his mouth speaks. So, you know, if we have problems, you know, in some of these areas, we need to read the Word of God. We need to have anchor scriptures that will help us get through. And we need to have more joy because we're here. And each and every one of us, you know, the fact that we are here is a miracle in itself. Every one of us is a miracle. The fact that when you consider going back to the beginning of time, and this person marries this person, or maybe has a child, you know, out of wedlock even. You know, those things all, whatever the circumstances were that led up to your birth, I mean, what are the chances? I mean, the chances are, I don't know what the chances are, but here we are, right? We're a miracle. And we want to make the most out of our lives. We want to enjoy them and all that God has for us. And the work that he has created us to do, it should be a privilege. And we will never know what it is unless we have a relationship with God. It says in Philippians 2:14, here's another verse. It says, do everything without complaining or arguing, because you are a miracle. And God loves you, and he has a work for you to do. We need to renew our minds. So we need to remove garbage from our minds. There's a lot of it up in there, just from living in the world, you know. And garbage in equals garbage out. So we have to be really careful what we watch, what we read. Where we go, garbage in, garbage out. We want to cultivate in us what God would want us to do. Read the scriptures. Have friends that are like-minded where you can study the scriptures and talk about who God is and what God means to you, what Jesus is and what he means to you, with the Holy Spirit in our lives, that a very intimate Godhead dwelling and living right inside of us, praying for us when we don't know what to pray for. You know, the scriptures say that the Holy Spirit groans on our behalf, praying for what it knows, what the Holy Spirit knows that we need in our lives when we don't even know. You know, very intimate. What a beautiful thing. We can surround ourselves with people and share our life experiences with God. We must feed our minds and our soul the Word of God instead of the garbage of this world. And there's a lot of garbage. I think it's why things are so violent today. You know, things are just out of hand. in so many areas. In Romans 12, 2, it says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. We need to clean out our spiritual closets. Hidden sin will destroy your life, your peace, and even your health. And the Bible says to confess your sins, tell someone and reach out for help, but you have to be really careful there. It's got to be someone that you can truly and totally trust. And when your spiritual closets are clean, the heaviness from hidden sin will lift. Tell God and confess to him. Talk to him on a daily basis. We all know what our sins are, usually. Sometimes we surprise ourselves and where we didn't see it. But basically, we know what our sins are, and we need to sit down with God on a daily basis and ask for forgiveness. And God does forgive, you know, and it needs to show in our actions. And our actions need to come from our heart. And that's how you know that it is real. Psalm 32, 3-5. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and you did not cover up my iniquity. I will confess my sins to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. So we have to remember that we need to acknowledge our sins to God and confess. It's more than just acknowledging, but we need to confess. Confess our sins to the Lord, and he will forgive us. And I mean, when he forgives, he forgets. We maybe haven't, because it's a process of, you know, going through restoration in our lives. But there comes a point where I think in order to clean out that spiritual closet, you need to forget too, because you have moved on. Because that can be way heavy on you. If you have dealt with it, if you have confessed it and talked to God about it and changed your life, it has come from your heart, then God sees your sin no more. And because we are sinful creatures, it is just the state of mankind. And that's why we need to do it, and God knows, and that's why he forgives us. So mercifully and graciously and lovingly, he forgives. It's a beautiful thing, and we can move on with our lives. Release unforgiveness and bitterness. That's something that we need to do. Any sin will weigh you down, but long-kept unforgiveness and bitterness, it's like old baggage in the attic you can't seem to part with. You're so used to it being there that you don't realize it's hindering your life. So we need to release unforgiveness and bitterness. Therefore, let us strip off every weight that slows us down. It says in Hebrews 12, verse 1. Especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress. In Ephesians 4, 31-32, it says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. So God, as he forgives us, we then need, in order not to be hindered in our lives, to be weighed down, we need to get rid of the bitterness and the resentments and our own unforgiveness of someone else's actions that perhaps hurt us. You know, that's what a resentment is. And, you know, that's a process too. So it takes time, but then you have to come to a point, you know, it's like you play it over and over in your mind all the time. You can't let it go. And I've come to the conclusion that when we do that and it's going on too long, that we're getting something out of it inside in our ego, you know. And you have to let it go because God doesn't do that to us. And he could, but he doesn't, because he came, he sent his son to save us regardless of what we have done. As long as we've asked forgiveness, he gives it. And so we must remember that resentment and having an unforgiving spirit can be like taking a poison pill, as we all say when we talk about this, but not dying, you know. It's just poison to the soul. We need to involve Jesus in our daily life. And I know about everybody here does. God bless you. You've blessed my life so much, all of you. You know, such beautiful people in this church. Just like last night after the storm, you know, Maria texting everybody, are you okay? Is everybody okay? And, you know, Maria is a widow. We should have been asking her, are you okay, Maria? God bless her, you know. Involving Jesus in our daily life. Think about others around you. Who might need some special attention, you know? And sometimes we're so busy and tired that all we want to do is go to bed. You know, it's just, I need a nap, you know. But sometimes we need to make an effort for people out there that could be lonely and really in great need. And I know I've heard many stories of people here, beautiful people that, you know, my friends that go out and do just that. And I thank you for it. What God wants most from each and every one of us is a relationship. He, you know, doesn't want us just to close the door and then when it's convenient, which we do sometimes, even to our parents when they're alive, you know. It can be that way, you know, you get so wrapped up in your own life. But, which it can be a healthy thing, you know. But we want to make sure that we spend time with God. He wants a genuine friendship with each and every one of us. He wants to be involved in all the big and the small moments of our lives. He is. God is our Father, you know, after all. He sent his son Jesus, who is God as well, to save us, his only begotten son. And most intimately, God, the Holy Spirit, dwells within each and every one of us. Do not turn away from that, because you will have a beautiful life if you listen to the Holy Spirit. Open your life to him and let his presence shine into every part, and you'll have no need for a yearly spiritual cleansing. Instead, you'll experience a daily moment-to-moment refreshing of your spirit. How beautiful is that? A moment-to-moment, daily refreshing of your spirit. How beautiful. 1 Corinthians 1:9, it says, God is the one who invited you into this wonderful friendship with his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. God is the one who invited you into this wonderful friendship. Talk about surrounding yourself with friends that love the Lord. But God has invited us to be friends with him. We are his children after all. And with his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In Psalm 56, verse 3, it says, "For you have rescued me from death. You kept my feet from slipping. So now I can walk in your presence, O God, in your life-giving light." That's David once again. "For you've rescued me from death, kept me, my feet from slipping. So now I can walk in your presence, O God, in your life-giving light." Just bathing ourselves and cleansing ourselves in the light and the presence of God. So beautiful. We also need to learn to laugh at ourselves and at life. And I do that all the time because, you know, after the great event of tragedy or whatever terrible thing has happened, yeah, sometimes I just laugh at myself for how I reacted and what eventually came of it. And that's a cleansing in itself. You know, when you laugh really hard, you know, it's like, wow, that felt good. It's not often that you laugh that hard, you know, but something will strike you, something in your life, and you just laugh, that deep laugh. It can be very cleansing. In Psalm 28:7, it says, "The Lord is my strength and shield. My heart trusts in him. My heart leaps for joy, and I will sing thanks to him in songs." And in Psalm 126:2, it says, "Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. It then was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them." Because they were laughing and singing songs of joy. The Lord has done great things for them, was said among the nations. In the book of Lamentations is my scripture verse. "It's great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning." It was written by Jeremiah, who was known to weep. He wept, and he had good reason to weep because Jerusalem had been destroyed by Babylon, and her people were either killed, tortured, or taken captive. You can read about it in the book of Lamentations. Jeremiah weeps for Jerusalem, and God is angry at their sins. But there is hope by the time you get to the third chapter, verses 22 and 23. If you want to open your Bibles up to Lamentations 3. It says, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." And then he says, "I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those who hope in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord," because it is coming. It has already come for us because Christ died and he was resurrected. He saved us. He conquered death. And we wait upon him. And he is our hope. He is the hope of mankind. And Jeremiah pleads then for restoration. In the midst of tragedy, there is great hope. As I was reading Lamentations, I read this scripture, I thought, something happened to Jeremiah because he went from weeping to proclaiming. Just try to visualize him after watching the people of Jerusalem being killed and slaughtered and taken captive and back to Babylon. And then having this experience that, you know, we weren't all annihilated. It was a great thing that God had done by saving them from complete and total annihilation. And when he came to the point where he could see this and God's providence and what it taught the people that were left, you know, he said, great is his faithfulness, his mercies begin afresh each morning. He was not weeping when he said it. No, he was expressing gratitude because there's going to be another morning, and there is for each and every one of us. Great is his faithfulness. His mercies begin afresh each morning. I need to change my ways in the morning. I need to get up and have that moment with God before I leave the house. But usually I'm just trying to get out the door. But really, it can set the tone for your whole day. I can remember being with Brenda Johnson, who was a pastor's wife, and I was at her house in Maine, and I'd get up in the morning, and she'd be making me breakfast, and I'd have my Bible out, and she would light a candle right by my, just my candle, a little candle by my placemat, just for me, you know. And it just changed everything. It just brought God in me into God's presence. And I thank you, Lord, for that. We all need to have those moments, just us and God. We need to do this spiritual cleansing, but it shouldn't be all ritual. It should be genuine, a genuine relationship with the Lord, genuine friendship with the Lord, being in his presence, and just being silent sometimes and listening to what God wants to tell us and how he's leading us. Remember, he is a light unto our path. He keeps our feet from slipping. And if we listen to the word of God and to his messages for ourselves each and every day, we will draw closer to him and we will be drawn into his presence and we will wait patiently for that day of his return, where we will be with Jesus in the heavenly kingdom with God, where we will meet all of those who had these wonderful experiences thousands of years ago, and articulated it so well for us in the Holy Scriptures. You know, they were articulate people. They knew how to express their feelings that we can identify with them today. It's a beautiful thing. May God bless each and every one of you as you open the scriptures, do a spiritual cleanse, and anyone that is going to clean out their house, you know, it sometimes starts right there. Let's have life lighter, easier, more joyful, and with more friends. Surround ourselves with good people. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day, this Sabbath day, for this divine hour of prayer and of lifting you up, of glorifying you, Lord, of reading the scriptures and of this of receiving messages that the Holy Spirit gives us understanding, accepting you as our Savior, Jesus Christ, today and every day. Thank you for your mercies, your forgiveness, and that the joy we can feel every single day because we are in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Diana, for that message. Great is his faithfulness. I got word today that Miss Lorna is leaving us. I got news that this is her last Sabbath with us. I don't want to cry, but I remember when I first met her. And she would tell so many wonderful stories. Growing up, her sister, her family, her mom. We are going to miss you. And I don't like that we only got a moment's notice of that. But we love you. We sing this in honor of you. May God continue to bless you, keep you, make his face smile upon you. And I know he will because we know that you truly love the Lord. It has shown in your walk, in your talk, in your life. So be sure to say goodbye to her. Please stand as we sing our closing song.
Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord, bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord.
Beside you, all around you, and within you, he
with you. He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. 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 He is for you.
Receive the blessing from the Lord God Almighty that you are saved, that you are forgiven, and that He wants a wonderful life for each and every one of you. And as we wait for the Lord's return, that He has a work for us to do. And in His name we pray this. Amen.